In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And my dear brothers and sisters, we enter into the 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time. And in today's liturgy is focused on the Thanksgiving. Eucharist itself is a thanksgiving as we come before the Lord. Somewhere or the other, we have received the favor from the Lord, but forgetting to thank the Lord. In this Eucharistic celebration, we surrender ourselves everything and ask God's pardon and forgiveness for our failures and shortcomings. With one voice we say, I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us of our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Joshua. In those days, Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to the people, "If you be unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." The people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of the bondage, and who did those great signs in our sight, and preserved us all in the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." The word of the Lord. Taste and see that the Lord is good. I will bless the Lord at all times. Praise of him is always in my mouth. In the Lord, my soul shall make its boast. The humble shall fear and be glad. Taste and see that the Lord is good. The Lord turns his eyes to the just, and his ears are open to their cry. The Lord turns his face against the wicked to destroy their remembrance from the earth. Taste and see that the Lord is good. When the just cry out, the Lord hears and rescues them in all their distress. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. Those whose spirit is crushed, he will save. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Many are the trials of the just man, but from them all the Lord will rescue him. He will keep guard over all his bones. Not one of his bones shall be broken. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Evil death to the wicked. Evil brings death to the wicked. Those who hate the just man are doomed. The Lord ransoms the souls of his servants. All who trusts in him shall not be condemned. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brethren, be subject to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, be subject to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and himself its Savior. As the church is subject to Christ, so let wives also be subject in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might be present, the church to himself, in splendor, without spot or wrinkle, or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Even so, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no man ever hates his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, and I mean in reference to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, many of the disciples of Jesus said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples murmured at it, said to them, "Do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you that do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who those were that did not believe and who it was that would betray him. And he said, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father." After this, many of the disciples drew back and no longer walked with him. Jesus said to the 12,
"Will you also go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ. My dear brothers and sisters, the origin of the Eucharistic celebration, the Jews thank God for two blessings, namely the gift of time and the gift of riches. They thank God for his gift of time by observing the last day of the week as Sabbath, a day of rest, worship and good works. They thank God for the gift of riches by offering tithes to the temple. The early Christian did the same by observing Sunday to participate in the Lord's Supper and by sharing what they had with the less fortunate ones in their faith community. The Eucharistic celebration has its root in the ancient Jewish Passover meal. Passover was celebrated both as a memorial feast and as a Thanksgiving meal commemorating the liberation of the chosen people from their slavery in Egypt. It was at such a Passover, or at the Last Supper as well, as we call it, that Jesus instituted the Eucharist. The three synoptic Gospels and St. Paul have handed on to us the account of the institution of this Last Supper or the Eucharist. By celebrating this meal with his apostles, Jesus gave the Jewish Passover its definitive meaning. His passage to the Father by death and resurrection. Jesus followed the ancient tradition and blessing the bread and wine. Then he gave the whole new meaning to the Passover feast when he took bread and blessed and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Matthew chapter 26, verses 26. After this, he took a cup of wine, gave thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant of my blood." Luke chapter 22, verses 20. Thus the Last Supper was both a farewell meal and a sacrifice. Jesus himself was the sacrifice because he offered his body and blood to God in sacrifice for all people. Jesus' command and its practice in the church. The command of Jesus, "Do this in memory of me," obliges us to repeat his actions and words until he comes. It also directs its apostles and their successor to carry out a liturgical celebration of Christ's life, death, resurrection, and intercession. From the beginning, the church has been faithful to the Lord's command. It was on the first day of the week, or Sunday, the day of Jesus' resurrection, that Christians met to break off the early church in Jerusalem. It is written in the Acts of the Apostles. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers, day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes. They partook of food with glad and generous heart. As early as the second century, we have the witnesses of Saint Justin the Martyr regarding the basic order of the Eucharistic celebration. Around the year 155, Saint Justin wrote to the pagan emperor Antoninus Pius, explaining to him the meaning of the Christian Eucharistic celebration. Down through the centuries, the church has been careful to preserve the basic structure of the Mass in all liturgical families, both in the East and in the West. Now we see the little bit of the theology of the Eucharistic celebration. The Eucharist is the one of the seven sacraments, that is, signs made sacred by Christ to show his presence in the world and help us to reach a closer union with God. It is a sacrament as well as a sacrifice. As a sacrifice, the Holy Eucharist is also known as the Holy Mass or Eucharistic celebration. It is a double commemoration of Jesus' Last Supper and his death and resurrection. It is recalled the Last Supper because it is holy meal that provides spiritual food for Christians, and it recalls Christ's redemptive sacrifice on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. The Eucharist is the heart and center of Catholic life. Hence, active participation in the Holy Mass is the best way to observe, to obey God's commandment, observe the Lord's Day holy, to express our faith and to share in the saving grace of Christ. The more we understand the meaning of the Eucharist, the more perfectly and faithfully we can offer the Eucharistic sacrifice and receive spiritual nourishment from this sacrament of the Holy Eucharist. The central act of Catholic worship. No doctrine in our Catholic faith has been more understood by non-Catholics than that of the Holy Mass. The Mass is the central act of Catholic worship. In the Mass, Christ's sacrifice on Calvary is perpetuated by the priest who offers it anew to the Father. It is not the new sacrifice, but rather the same sacrifice that Jesus offered on the cross 2,000 years ago. The difference, however, is that Jesus no longer dies at each Mass, but is simply re-offered to the Father. It is a bloody sacrifice only in the sense that it contains the body and blood of Christ. But it is unbloody in the sense that it is offered only a sacramental fashion under the appearance of bread and wine. In the Mass, we represent or mystically renew the sacrifice of Calvary. This means that once again we offer Christ to the Father, saying, "Father, look upon the Lamb that was slain for our sake." Through this holy and perfect sacrifice, pardon our sins and be opposed by the pleasing order of the unblemished Lamb. By the words of the consecration, Christ is made present again through the transubstantiation of the bread and wine into Christ's body and blood. By giving us the Mass, our Lord ensured for us a means of applying all generations the graces merited on His holy cross. As James Cardinal Gabons noted, "In the sacrifice of the Mass, I apply to myself the merits of the sacrifice of the cross, from which the Mass derives its entire efficacy." The Church also teaches that the chief fruit of the Eucharist is an intrinsic union of the recipient with Christ. Be a Eucharistic person. In simple terms, this means imitating Jesus in our thoughts, words, and action. The Eucharist is body broken and blood poured out for others. Accordingly, we will participate fully in the benefits of the Eucharist only to the extent that we imitate in all aspects of our lives the generosity and unselfishness that we see in the life and death of Jesus Himself. The Eucharist will certainly help us to be more thoughtful and compassionate and forgiving Eucharistic person. By this cannot happen without our own serious commitment to love and serve others. Just as Jesus brought the good news of God's love, salvation, and healing to the world, so must we. This means that we must care for others, feed them, forgive them, accept them, and help them to become children of God. In these ways, we may truly become Eucharistic person. Live a Eucharistic life by extending the celebration of the Paschal mystery into our daily lives. This means that as faithful follower of Jesus, our praise, suffering, prayers, and work must be united with His total offering. In this way, our actions acquires new value in the light of the Eucharistic mystery. No life is without meaning or worth. Where there appears to be no meaning or worth, the Eucharist brings hope and inspiration. So receive Jesus in holy communion with proper preparation. The Catechism of the Catholic Church reminds us of two requisites for receiving communion. First, our conscience must be free from mortal sin. To respond to this invitation, we must prepare ourselves for so great and so holy a moment. St. Paul urges us to examine our conscience. And he says, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of profaning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a man examine himself and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. Anyone conscious of a grave sin must receive the sacrament of reconciliation before taking Holy Communion. The frequent use of confession is an indication that the person's spiritual life is in good shape, that he is struggling to overcome sins and weaknesses. Secondly, we must fast 1 hour before we receive Holy Communion. To prepare for worthy reception of this sacrament, the faithful should observe the fast required in their church. Bodily gesture, clothing ought to convey the respect, solemnity, and joy of this moment when Christ becomes our guest. Amen.
And now let us stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we are reminded how God always protects his people, in faith we seek God's continued protection today as we offer our prayers of petition.
Let us keep in prayer Pope Francis, all bishops and priests, that through their teaching may the good news of God's kingdom be open to all people. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the leaders of all governments throughout the world to act with concern for the well-being of all, and their leadership be showed by genuine humility and a desire to serve. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for our faith community, that God may grant us the grace to lead better lives, walking in faith and following the teaching of Jesus by coming to the assistance of the needy. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all married couples. May God continue to bless their union as they grow in love for each other and their children. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the sick and all who are in hospital, may they know that God's love never fails in strengthening the weak, encouraging the fearful, and healing the sick. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all those who have died, that may they rejoice and dwell in the everlasting light of God's love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. And in the silence of our heart, we pray silently our own needs. Lord, hear us. We also pray for peace in Southern Africa. O God of justice and love, bless us the people of Southern Africa and help us to live in your peace. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, let me sow pardon. Where there is discord, let me sow harmony. Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, to receive sympathy as to give it. For it is in giving that we shall receive, in pardoning that we shall be pardoned, in forgetting ourselves that we shall find unending peace with others. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Loving Father, you hear and answer our prayers. Grant that we may know and accept your loving will in our lives. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption, through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestowed graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gather them again to yourself, that a people form as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ the temple of the Holy Spirit, might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the church. And so, in company with the chorus of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, Saint Francis, Saint Clare, Saint Padre Pio, Saint Teresa, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and Stephen Brislin, our Bishop, Sylvester David, his auxiliary, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you. At their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestowed on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold Him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Gracious is the Lord, slow to anger.